All right, it's 12:03, so I think it is time for us to get started. I'm sure some other folks will join as we go. But Kellie, it is great to have you here today. Good to talk to you.
I'm so excited to be here. This is going to be so much fun.
I am very pumped. Well, thanks to all who are joining. I know this time of year can be quite busy, so we appreciate you taking the time. We are really excited to have you here today to talk about your 2020 business resolutions. Hard to believe it's just around the corner, but now is the time to be getting ready as event professionals. For those who don't know us, my name is Karen Gordon. I'm the VP of Growth here at Goodshuffle Pro. We are software for event companies. We work with rental, production, and design companies all over the US and Canada to help them streamline their business operations.
Yes, and I'm Kellie Daab. I'm the founder of Wedding Industry Institute. I help wedding professionals scale their business and market and message it with ease so that it operates seamlessly. All right, so let's go into what we're going to talk about today. I think that's the next big step here. So we're going to go into marketing resolutions. So the first thing we're going to talk about is setting some real marketing goals. Then our sales resolutions, then productivity and task management. We're going to talk about financial budgeting for the next year. And then we're going to go into planning to scale, as well as some resources that we have for you at the end so that you have everything you need as you grow into 2020. And then we are going to answer questions at the end. As you can see at the bottom of your screen, you have a question box. If you will put your questions in there as we go, we will be tracking questions. And at the end, we will open up for any additional questions that you have, and we'll stay with you to answer those questions. So just drop them into the box and we'll answer them all at the end. Are you ready, guys, ready to get started?
I'm super ready. I've got this quote here to inspire us, and I thought it was perfect for today. I found from this author of this this book, Resolutions That Stick, he said, "Instead of trying to change your entire life in January, the simpler strategy is to adopt a 12-month plan where you're making constant improvements." And what I like about this is the idea here of we all tend to do this thing where we kick the can down to January, and then there's sort of that holiday hangover almost of, oh, the friends and the family are leaving and I'm trying to get through things, and before you know it, it's February. And I'm sure everyone can relate to that feeling of pushing things off. And so there's no time like the present. There's no reason that you shouldn't be starting your resolutions now, even if it's taking the baby steps or just getting yourself ready to start. And kudos to everybody who's logging in. Kudos to everybody who's watching the recording later, because you are already doing that. You are getting that head start on your resolutions now, which is the first sign of success for your 2020 business goals.
That's right. And so even if you're drinking a cup of hot chocolate or have a Christmas cookie in your hand, I don't. Someone send me some. Let's get digging into talking about marketing. All right. Before, though, we dig into fixing anything for 2020, I want to actually take a second and look back and see what was working in 2019 and what's not been working. This quick assessment, this literally two-question assessment, what is working and what is not working, will really allow you to have a really good picture of what you need to improve, obviously, and what maybe you need to drop or let go. So you want to look at working things. These are things like high conversion rates. So you put out a new initiative, or you sold a new product and it converted really, really well. That's working for you. Maybe you're getting a good amount of click-throughs on an ad, or you're getting high engagement on a particular type of video or a social post. The right kind of inquiries are starting to come in. So you know that the copy on your website might be working. Look at those things. What are some things that you did in 2019 that are really working on your behalf? And then look at, how do I do more of those things, right? Let's look at what's not working. So these might be things like, maybe you're not getting any ROI on the last event that you did. Maybe it was a collaboration event, a styled shoot, or bridal show, some of those kinds of things. And you're like, eh, that didn't really pan out. Maybe you're looking at ads and they're just bombing and you're like, oh, why am I spending money here? Maybe that is something that's not working and you need to get some support, right? Maybe you're spending money on listings that you're not really getting any ROI out of, or products that you created that just are not selling. Once you've kind of determined what's not working, you can clearly see what needs to be improved, what you maybe you should toss out or revise, right? And you can get some support for those things that aren't working in your marketing. When you assess what is working, you can then determine how to do more of that action, right? How do I write more social posts that convert like this? How do I attract more? How do I change more of my website copy to fit this kind of client that I'm attracting, right? How do I write more content or create better, interesting content to attract more of that person, okay? You might also then go, what are some other initiatives that are similar to what I did that's working that I can introduce in 2020, right? So now what we want to do is I really want you to set some really specific marketing goals or KPIs. KPIs stand for key performance indicators. Now, key performance indicators are based on your particular strengths. They're also based on that big goal, okay? So you're setting a big goal for your business. Let's say it's converting more, let's say it's whatever, you're going to take that KPI and set a very specific number for how you're going to do. So let's say you want your ads to perform at a certain level, you're going to give that KPI a very specific and measurable number. So here's an example. If your Instagram is doing well for you, all right, and you might focus a KPI on a click-through rate to your website from Instagram. So you might say, I want to see at least 20 click-throughs from my Instagram to my website each month, in 2020, or 20 in the first month, 30 in the next month, right? So you're tripling on your business. So you can make those KPIs so specific that you can measure them very easily. Did I reach 20 clicks? No, I didn't. Then what efforts do I need to take? All right. So for example, we are looking at a KPI of reaching a certain number of people, 1,000 people. What actions do I have to take as a business to reach 1,000 people, right? So really, really dig into what that is. Now, that's just a basic marketing audit, okay? When you get through that, we want to actually talk about how are you closing business, because that's the next step after getting marketing all set up.
Yes, and I was telling Kellie, I had a bit of a laugh over Thanksgiving because my mother, who is a retired early childhood specialist, has not had a whole lot of experience in the business world, and I was talking a bit about different sales and marketing challenges, and she finally had that head-scratching moment where she said, so it's a different department that's supposed to bring in clients versus actually close the business? And I said, yes, yes, that is marketing versus sales. So once you're getting to your sales resolutions, you know, of course it's great to have that click-through rate. Of course it's great to see that you're getting a ton of engagements on Instagram, but you have to see if they're translating to sales. And not just if they're translating, but what type of sales they're translating to. So a good exercise is for you to create a list of your top events and your worst events too. But one thing you should be careful of as you're thinking through your top events is there's some common traps that people fall into when you have an idea of what was a big success. So a few things to recognize when you think about top events. One of the things that it's not is your favorite clients, right? The cool people, the most creative people, sometimes even the biggest names. You want to be careful that you're not just assuming that X event was your coolest and therefore it was your best. It's not your highest grossing event. So you might have had this first time ever where you got this insane paycheck and it felt really, really good. But of course you need to think through your cost. You need to think through, okay, what was my net? Now that said, it's not even necessarily your highest netting events that you should be focused on. There's a couple things you need to think through and remember when you're looking at, of course, net being a big part, but one is to think through time versus revenue. And you'll notice that time is a really big emphasis for us today. It's a passion of both of ours. If you look back and you have this really high netting event that you did that you're really proud of, but it basically took you away from doing anything else. You didn't do anything else for, let's say, the month of June because it just took all of your time and resources. That really needs to be factored in when you're thinking about your biggest wins. There are also some ancillary benefits you should think about. So I mentioned before the idea of a favorite because you worked with, let's say, for example, a name brand or a celebrity or something like that. Now, you don't want to get too stuck in the path of assuming it's your best event just because it's good gossip at the holiday parties this year to tell everyone that you worked with so-and-so. But of course, if it's helping your marketing materials, let's say you got really beautiful photos out of an event, or you got the testimonial from a celebrity on your website saying that you were wonderful to work with. Of course, those things should be factored in. So you should have a healthy mix when you're looking at your top events. Most of them should be highest netting. Of course, that is the point. You are trying to run a business and make money. But you, of course, may have a couple of others that provided enough ancillary benefits, or even those that were sort of mid-range in terms of the net, but took you very little time to execute. Now, once you have this list of your top events of 2019, I want you to really think through the sales process. And again, it is really important to separate the marketing part. Of course, you want to go all the way back to that as well. But once they were in your funnel, once you had these leads, what was the process that took them the rest of the journey? Because again, that's really the sales process. Everything from the number of calls you made to that client, the number of emails. What was the method of sale? Was it that you showed them your portfolio? Was it that you really walked them through the vision of their event? And not only thinking through this full journey, I want you to write it all out, which, by the way, if you don't already have a pen and paper out or a notepad or Microsoft Word document open on your computer, I would encourage you to take the time to do it now, because I know I'm not always great with rewatching a webinar later. So if you're already on here, go ahead and follow along with us. And really start thinking through what are some of the touches of some of these highest clients, most important events. And then not just what were the touches and the number of touches, but what was the final one? What pushed them over the edge? When you're thinking about this process and you're writing these steps, I want you to think about which aspects are repeatable. People sometimes say, well, I got to work with Coca-Cola this year and do a big party for them, or, oh man, I got to work with this, you know, reality star, but it was a total fluke. It was luck. You know, I called her cousin John, who kind of knew so-and-so. That's not really what happened. If that was the case and you had a friend of a friend, perhaps what's valuable there and repeatable is networking. Or perhaps what you really did is you created what is called social proof. You made it clear that there are others who trust and like you, and by doing so, you got that business. So try and find which aspect is repeatable. Don't let it fall to luck or a fluke. Another thing you have to be careful of is not to flatter yourself too much. And I will confess, I'm a little guilty of this, where I think, man, I got the client over the edge. It was me, right? It was my, you know, distinct, charming personality or the way that I communicate. It's something that I'm doing that's really unique to me. But the fact is that there are skills like this that are trainable. They are coachable. And as we get to talking about scaling your business later, one of the important things is you cannot have your sales process start and end with you. You cannot sit there and say, well, I have to be the one to touch every client really to get them over the edge. Because again, that is not scalable. That is not how the biggest and the best in this business work. They have figured out what they do so well, and they have trained their team to do that. And there needs to be no exceptions to that. So you're looking at that list of your top events this year. Let's say the majority of them were somewhat similar. You had a similar journey, a similar process, and what pushes them over the edge is, you know, X, Y, and Z type of language that you use in an email along with a beautiful proposal. Well, then you look and you say, but we had that one that I put on my top list because it got us the best photos. Or I have that one that was really turnkey. It didn't make us a ton of money, but I could probably have those, you know, 10 of those next year and really make some good money. Well, you need to make sure that you create that separate sales path, that journey for your one-offs. There are no exceptions, because where you're going to get caught is if you become someone who says, well, we have a process for 70% of our clients, but there's 30% who are special. They have all these ancillary benefits that I know about, and that's just really special. I have to do all of those. Again, depending on the size of your business, it might even just be you, and you might be the person who's able to touch those for now, but that's not scalable. And so you should make sure that you have a unique process, even for those somewhat unique cases. Because when you do that, one of the things you're setting yourself up for is saving yourself time. You're not floundering with each of these different clients. You have a clear path and a clear process, and it's going to save you time, which is the thing that everyone in this business really needs the most, right?
Yes, time is my favorite subject in the whole wide world. We talk about productivity. We talk about time all the time, literally. And when it comes to the topic of productivity, we almost always think of time as if it's an equal, but running out of time, quote unquote, is a symptom, not a diagnosis. I'm going to say that again. Running out of time is a symptom. It's not a diagnosis of the problem in your business. So typically when I talk with students or clients and they tell me that they can't get anything done because of time, right? Air quotes time. I always ask one follow-up question. So if you're feeling crunched by time, I want you to write this question down, grab that notebook, write down right now. Okay. Ready? What are you spending the most time on? Okay, what am I spending the most time on? Quote unquote time, all right? The answer to this question for you will help you to reveal really only two things. It will reveal your priorities, okay? So what are you spending the most time on? Likely the thing you're spending the most time on is the most important thing to you, all right? This is a priority for you, right? And it will also show me equally where you need the most support in your business, okay? So if you're spending a lot of time doing one particular task in your business, for me, sometimes I can get really caught up in admin stuff, right? And so I'm like, oh, this section of my business really, really needs support, okay? And so I don't really need to be doing that. It's not where I need to be going, and I'm gonna show you how to figure that out later. But we also need to go, hey, how do I get help? Or how do I stretch my time inside of this one area that is either a priority or where I need support, okay? How you spend the bulk of your time will show you what you need to fix in your business. So where are you spending the majority of time? Look at that, write it down. Also, let's really, really dig in here and say, if you're endlessly scrolling on Facebook, or maybe you're spending a ton of time sourcing, or maybe you're spending all your time delivering things or setting up things or answering emails, like I said, I get stuck in admin. You need to pinpoint those three things that require the majority of your time. Now that you've determined what those three areas of time loss are in your business, you can then go, how can I fix this? All right. And really, there's only three ways to fix a time problem. And I know everyone's like, what? That doesn't make sense. But the real truth is there really is only three ways. You add people, you set up better processes, and you create a productivity plan, okay? So we are going to talk about each one of those three. So I want you to look at all of these three things and say, can this be outsourced? Can I add a team member or create a job description that will do this particular thing that I have been spending the majority of my time doing? All right. Can I add people, even if it's a contractor or a VA outside of your business, that can take over some of those things? Then I want you to look at your processes. So many people in the creative event industry have such a wide range of processes. I know working in catering, right? I worked in sales, but that also meant that I was packing trucks and delivering things at Christmas time. The processes by which you follow in your business are massive. So I want you to look at from the beginning to end of a single event, what are the processes? Write them down. And then I want you to look at those and say, can I collapse any of these things into the other thing? Can this one thing save time here? If we do this one action, or we load this at this time instead of at this time, can I collapse my time and save time? Can I create a better way of doing this? Maybe the way that you've got your stock loaded isn't the most efficient, right? You're spending a lot of time moving things around. So can you create some standard operating procedures so that your new team members or so that your clients aren't emailing you at 2 o'clock in the morning, right? Maybe you need forms and templates or resources for your team so that they can be empowered to do the job for you. All of those things will save you time. then once you look at those processes and you've like evaluated them, you can take those and plug them into some kind of software or a system of some sort or a project management tool that will allow you to work smarter and faster. A lot of times when I get caught in my business and I'm having a process issue, usually I think, oh, I need to outsource this. I'm overwhelmed, right? And sometimes the real truth is I need to back up, look at the process, and then see if I can find a tool or a system that will make it go faster. So if you're having inventory problems, what software will fix that? If you're having productivity problems, what tool can you use to manage your projects? If you're having issues with creating information for your clients quickly, what portal can I use, right? All of those things. In my business, I use Trello, I use Dubsado, I have email marketing systems, I have course systems. All of that stuff is what really makes my business efficient. And I can keep a smaller team because those systems act in the place of people sometimes. Lastly, if you are losing time because of your own behaviors, like scrolling or feeling unfocused, or you are like, maybe you don't like technology, right? And so you are, you know, like pushing it away, okay? You need to find some new productivity hacks for your life, all right? No one is telling you you have to do it a certain way. What we're telling you is that you have to find your way. You have to find the way your brain thinks and plug some things in. So one of my favorite ways of getting back on track in your business is to do a brain dump. I don't know about you, but it's December. I'm not sleeping because I'm dreaming of things I'm supposed to be wrapping and buying. And oh, did I remember that thing? And oh my gosh, what's that cookie recipe again? And oh, by the way, are you finishing that email you're supposed to send out? All of those things are in my head all at the same time. And so my favorite method is sitting down in a quiet space and just brain dumping everything out. Get a big piece of paper. I use a big whiteboard, right? Write it all down. Brain dump it all out of your head, even personal things, all of those things. The idea is that you're taking everything out of your brain and you're writing it down into one giant pile, okay? Now, a lot of you might already have this laying on your desk. The last time I asked this question at Wedding MBA, people were like, oh, I already have one of those. It's like 3 pages long on a legal pad on my desk. And the real problem is that doesn't help you. It just stops you because then you have this really long list and you're not going to tackle it. So we're going to talk about, hey, right now, how we're going to break this list down even further. Okay, so we're going to take this big list and make it usable and productivity friendly. So I want you to filter this list. So back in the day, there used to be a TV show, I think it's like Hoarders or something, and the people would go in and they would empty the house, okay? And the job of the owner was to create 3 piles, the keep, sell, and toss pile, right? And these were the things that were going to go back into the house, okay, that were precious to them, that meant something, that required that they were the owners, that they did it, right? Or that they had it. Then there was a sell pile. Those are things that could be sold to someone else, right? And then there's a toss pile. These were things that they really didn't need. They had in their purview, but they didn't really need. So I want you to take that big long list and I want you to break it down into keep piles. As the CEO of this company, I have to keep these things. In my business, I have to do all of the writing, okay? Nobody talks like me or thinks like me. So I have to keep everything related to copywriting, but I can sell admin tasks and I can sell things like managing marketing and I can sell away to a team member something else like setting up the emails after I write them, okay? Now, if we're looking at TOS, I want you to go and say, is this thing getting me closer to that KPI I set for my business? Is this thing helping me grow my business? If not, a lot of times, let's be really honest, you have things on your list you should just toss. They're just ideas, they're just initiatives that you're thinking about, but they're not actually going to get you closer to your end goal. You don't have to create everything that you think of, okay? So toss some things off your list, right? I once met with someone who told me she's got a pile of 7 books and she keeps putting it on her list to read those 7 books. Well, she's never going to read those 7 books if she keeps writing read 7 books on her to-do list. That's a toss item. And it becomes something in step two that's just fulfilling. So let's look at step two. Now that you've separated that into the keep, sell, and toss pile, I want you to look at each pile and I want you to separate that pile into things that are first emergent. Like, this has to be done or Susie, client, is going to get really mad and write a bad review, okay? Or I need to get this done in order to make money, okay? Or I need to do these things. This is like right now has to get done. It has a due date. It's emergent. The next thing you want to look at is revenue generating. So a lot of times we have all these tasks on our list, but they're not actually making us money. And we're spending time doing things that don't make us money, right? So I want you to really look at your list every single day when you sit down to work. Do the emergent things first and then the revenue generating things. This is going to make us money, right? The next thing after that is goal reaching. So you set that big KPI, right? Whatever that big KPI is. And I want you to look at your list and say, what things help me reach my goal? All right. Then after that, you add in the things that fulfill you. So let's say education fulfills you, or reading that book, or making sure you have time to spend with your family. All of those things that fulfill you and keep you going as a human, that needs to be part of your list of things to do. Then after that, what you're going to do is grab out some, you know, colored pencils, some markers or whatever. Okay. And then I want you to really look at that list and I want you to go, what things only take me 10 minutes? Mark those things. These things only take 10 minutes. The next step is, what things take me 30 minutes? What things take me 60 minutes? And what things are going to take me 2 hours or more? The reason why we do this is because oftentimes you see this ginormous list and you're like, I can't tackle that. And what I tell people is, do you have 30 minutes? If you have 30 minutes, you might be able to get 3 10-minute tasks done. Okay. Also, let's be real and admit that most of the time we look at a task and think, oh my gosh, that's going to take me forever. And it really doesn't. We really overestimate how much time, or sometimes if you're me, you underestimate how much time something is going to take you. By really getting an idea of how much time it's going to take you, you're able to really dig in and say, okay, I've got an hour. These are the 4 things I need to do because they're emergent and revenue generating. I need to do 3 emergent tasks that take 10 minutes. And then I have 30 minutes to do this revenue generating task that's going to take me 30 minutes. You can much more easily see how quickly you can use your time to be more productive. Now, I use a Trello board to do this. So I keep big goals and then I have additional goals in 90 days and 60 days and 30 days. And I keep my big giant brain dump in a Trello board and then I slide things through my productivity. I break them down literally to the day of the week I'm going to do the task. And then when I get to that day, every morning I sit down and I look at what's going to take me 10 minutes, 30 minutes, 60 minutes, 2 hours or more, right? And then I can base my day and how I get things done on those things. Now, one more quick productivity hack is, if you're building new initiatives or you're adding new offers in your business, right? Build one bridge at a time. Take a second and say, this initiative is going to take me these 10 tasks. Do that initiative first, especially if it is emergent or revenue generating. In essence, what you're doing here is you're shortening the amount of time that you're spending getting things done. And it's a great way to stay productive, even when your business gets busy in those really high seasons. It also removes that notion that you should be able to keep all of your tasks in your head. And it allows you the opportunity to bring in people that can help you manage those tasks. Because we all know that time is the one thing that is not refillable, right? There's no free refills on time. So time also means that when you're doing other things in your business that aren't generating revenue, you aren't making money. We all know time equals money. So let's talk about how your time impacts your money.
Yes, I know that time seems to be a big theme. Again, it really is one of the most important things that can separate your business from being successful or more successful or not. And so when people think about financial budgeting, oftentimes they think about the concept of looking at the money you've spent this year and trying to figure out where you can cut, right? That's sort of what we think about with budget. Oh, maybe I can buy the store brand Triscuit crackers or something like that. But really one of the very first things you should think about in your financial budgeting is where is time impacting your finances. So there are three really common themes that I see in terms of traps where people don't spend money. They think they are quote unquote saving money, but it's actually at their cost because that costs them time. So one example is people who are doing tedious tasks. You know, you're doing some sort of copy and paste between multiple systems because you don't want to upgrade to a nicer system that merges those tasks together. Or you say, well, I can go through and comb through every invoice I have to see which ones are using this service. Well, there's tons of software. Of course, I'm a little biased here coming from a software company, but it really does kill me to hear people say, well, my solution for that, as opposed to software or a tool or even hiring out, as Kellie mentioned, is just that I do this tedious task. And I find it to be almost an insult to yourself. That is significantly below your pay grade, right? You're not being, you know, if you're a owner or a general manager or a system manager or wherever you are in your career, your job is likely not to do something like combing through things looking for one thing. These are tasks that there are literal robots now for, right? We're going into 2020 here. And that kind of time waste is actually costing you because you think about the cost of your time and the money you could be making, as Kellie mentioned, and to be dumping that away at a tedious task is a very good example of how that is draining your finances. Another common issue we see in the way that people spend their time in a financial impact is spending time on things that are a clear weakness for them. So I want to be careful when I say that. I personally have worked for startups and small companies most of my career. So I have had to learn tons of things that are not necessarily my strength. I've worn many, many hats over the years. And I think it's important to learn and grow, especially if you are someone who owns a small business. That said, there's a difference between saying, oh, you know, I'm not super techie, but I'm great with design. And I know that Squarespace and WordPress are pretty easy, so I'm going to watch some YouTube videos and learn how to build my site. That's an example of, hey, like it's a challenge for me, but I'm going to learn something new. However, if you are someone who is terrible with numbers, you got, you know, bad grades in math your whole life, learning your own accounting is actually hurting your business. Because while you say, well, I don't want to pay an accountant, and that bottom line I'm saving, the amount of time you're taking to learn this thing that is really difficult for you, you're not only building in the time to learn something new, but you're pretty much doubling, tripling it, depending on just how bad you are at math. And you're wasting all of this time desperately trying to learn something that you as an adult probably already know is always going to be a struggle. Even if you take a class in accounting, even if you watch every YouTube video, even if you listen to every podcast to get some tools to help you, if that is something you know is your true absolute weakness, it's something where chances are the cost of outsourcing it, of having somebody come in and help, is going to negate the amount of time. And again, thinking of your time as an actual dollar sign on it, it's going to completely outweigh the waste of time of really pushing yourself on something that is a really line in the sand, tough weakness for you. The last common thing we see with people who think they are saving time, think they are saving money when they are wasting time, is habit. And just as a funny note, I wanted to put my icon for habit as an abacus for those people who know what that is. But I asked in my office, and apparently, I'm getting to be old lady style here because people didn't know what an abacus was, so I changed the graphic to paper and pencil as my example of old habits. But it actually works really well for a common example I think of. I have a hairstylist who I've been going to for many, many moons, and they take their appointments with an actual pencil and paper. Now, as you can probably all likely guess, they have messed up my appointment more than once. I go because I love the way they do my hair, and I really love the family who runs it. But this family-run business says to me, because I've made my opinion known, you know, we've always done it this way. And hey, business is booming. And sure enough, in the decade I've gone there, I've watched their business grow. They have beautiful branding now. The younger generation has sort of taken over and has made things a little more modern looking. But at the end of the day, I can guarantee you it'd be more booming and more financially efficient with software. Because if they had messed up the appointment like they did for me, for somebody who was less loyal than I am or who didn't happen to love this one stylist the way I do, they've lost that business. And the costs there, the financial drain, not only from their time being wasted, but the additional drain on what that does for their business, it is completely ruining their quote unquote money saved that they perceive that they are saving because they're not getting software. They're not moving forward with the times. So once you've gone through, what are the things that are my time sucks? What are the things that are literally costing me money because they are too tedious for my skill set? They are way too hard for me to learn and relearn over and over again. Or there's something I've never even realized, but I'm just stuck in my old habits, just stuck in my old ways. And each minute I'm doing that habit, writing that appointment with pencil, I am costing my business money. The next thing to do is a more traditional financial audit. I've gotten my time. I'm going to find ways to save money there. It is now time to review your actual dollar spend. One of the first things I would encourage you to look for are hidden fees. It seems that these have been becoming more common. I think we're also used to just sort of agreeing to things and not reading the terms and conditions. And unfortunately, a lot of businesses take advantage of that. And there are hidden fees in places that you might not realize. When you find these fees, there's two things you can do. One, you'd be surprised how many of those can be negotiable. I'm not sure if anyone has ever called their cable company, for example. I've had many heated discussions with Comcast. Just gonna put that out there. And you can actually sometimes call and see, are these negotiable? Are these something that we can spread out a different way, lump together, I can get out of, you know, this is creeping up in the costs. Obviously, another thing you're going to look for is, are there competitors without them? You know, a new year is a great time to say, hey, last I checked, my personal building doesn't allow me to have anything besides Comcast. But to be honest, last time I checked was probably 5 years ago. So it's a good time for you to explore if there's competition that offers the same service, a similar service, but without any additional hidden fees, because we all know those add up. The next thing to review are what I call your nice to haves. Now, a lot of people jump to just abandoning these, right? I don't need to have this. I don't need to have this. Well, don't jump to abandoning. Nice to have does not imply that it is not important. There are things that are nice to haves that have legitimate ROI. For example, we'll oftentimes send like a thank you first to someone as a referral fee. Like, hey, you referred us a business. Here is an Amazon gift card. Those are quote unquote nice to have. But if you can look back and say, man, the last 10 people I gave a Starbucks gift card to, 5 of them came back and worked with me again. That's a legitimate ROI, and you can sit and easily crunch those numbers and see that the nice to have is actually growing you money. Now, I will also point out that sometimes a nice to have is also nice to have for you. You're allowed to be giving yourself some moments of sparking joy, as Marie Kondo says. You know, I had a friend who was obsessed with Starbucks. She was determined to cut it out of her budget. And so she didn't have Starbucks for many weeks. And she said she was really blue about it. She'd always looked forward to it. She likes pushing her kids into their strollers to go get the Starbucks. She realized it wasn't just the coffee, which she was trying to replace. It was the habit. It was seeing the people she knew who worked there. It was the walk there. So she came up with a bit of a compromise and said, look, this is something I really enjoy. I think she limited the number of days she was going there and maybe what crazy order she was getting. But of course, you can have somewhere in your budget for your own happiness. But then when you look at the need to haves, a couple of traps that you should watch out for as well. One is this a need to have that is actually data backed? So one example is I was talking to a client who said, well, you know, we spend so much money on Facebook ads and we spend also a lot of money on AdWords as well. And I said, oh, that's interesting. Do you get a lot of your business from AdWords? And they said, well, yeah, we've gotten some business. And I said, how much? What percentage? And they had no idea. And that comes back to the important marketing KPIs that Kellie touched on in the beginning. You can't just say, well, obviously I have to have advertising. I have to have marketing. Well, then you could go through your whole budget and anything related to marketing or advertising, you would just say have to have. You need to make sure that you are spending these need to haves in the right places. And along with that, not only seeing that direct data-backed ROI, but also thinking through where's the efficiency and where's the value. So one example that of course comes to mind for me working on the software side is someone says, well, I have software that I have spent all this money on, but you know, sometimes it doesn't really work for me. And I'll say, come again. So you're telling me you spent a bunch of money on some program or sometimes it's a consultant and it's not really working for you. Well, that's the same as running these Google ads if they're not turning around for you. Is it the most efficient? Is it the fastest? Is it saving you time along with your money? And if you're using old software or if you're using an inefficient tool, then you're basically taking that money and throwing it down the toilet because it is time and that equals money. And not to sound extra harsh, but unfortunately, this also does apply to people. You can look at your staff costs for the year and say, well, that's a big drain. But of course, I have to have people. But now is a wonderful time when you're looking at your New Year's resolutions to say, here's the dollar amount that is assigned to that person. Are they actually giving me, you know, whatever it may be, $20 an hour worth of results? Are they really giving me X number of dollars a year worth of results? And making sure that, yes, this is a need to have line item. I have to have staff. I have to have technology. I have to have a roof over my head. But are these all the most efficient? Are they the best bang for my buck in terms of value? And then the last thing I'm going to say about reviewing your spend, and it sounds a little bit backwards, but it's actually spending more. So if something worked really well for you, let's say you took out an ad in your local paper and you got a ton of hits on that. Now, I have a little bit of a hard time believing that being the digital focused person I am, but hey, if it worked for you, do you think it would perform twice as high if you were to actually take a full page ad next time? Or when you were going through your need to haves and you realize, you know, Google ads really aren't performing for me, but hey, Facebook ads really are. It's important to run the exercise of, well, if I were to double my spend there, would it actually double my ROI? And then finally, where have I not even thought to spend money yet? Whether that's in my marketing department, in my sales department, in my operations department, and again, these could all be you, but where have I not tested spending money yet? Because hopefully, once you've gone through the exercises of being careful on your time and being careful on your spend, you've now pulled back your spends in quite a few places, and you now have a little bit of play money. And that play money should be used wisely, but towards something that you are going to test in the new year, which you never know, that could be your silver bullet, and that could end up being the main thing that drives you business. And that's sort of the whole point of having a New Year's resolution, is to have these new avenues you're testing out.
Yeah, that's really powerful, because when you are in this phase between the business of 2019 and what I'm looking for in the next year, you really need to be looking at the space between, and we call this the planning to scale phase, right? I don't know a single business that says, I don't want to do better next year, right? Like, if that's you, then cool. Let's have a chat and you explain to me why you say that. But everyone is looking at next year and they're going, you know what? I want to scale this, or I want to do this. I want to make these changes for next year. So let's talk about the planning to scale phase, okay? Now, this is the space in between the actual scaling actions, okay, and I have these things I just assessed, my marketing and all these other things, right? We talked about your marketing, getting your tasks in order and productivity. We talked about managing your cash flow, and there's really a good reason for that, because it requires a high level of understanding of the multifaceted approaches of your business in order to scale your business into next year. You've got to look at all of that and create a plan to scale, all right? So as you're looking at next year, we need to determine what you want, okay, where you're going, and how are you going to get there? So you've heard that big phrase, you have to begin with the end in mind. You guys have heard that, right? Now, I want you to take a second and look at 2020. Maybe you close your eyes, whatever, envision what you want your business to be. And I want you to set some big, scary goal for 2020. Okay, something really big, something that scares your socks off, something that really, really feels like I can achieve this. It's scary, but I can do it. All right, I want you to set some kind of big goal. Likely when I said that, something popped in your head right away. Maybe it's a number of bookings, okay? Maybe it's a certain level of revenue. Maybe it's a certain number of SKUs or an additional product offer, right? Maybe you are looking at spending less time in your business, and that's a big scary goal. How do I step down and do less and build more team? Whatever that is, I want you just to write that down really quickly. Okay, now you have a big scary goal, okay, but you need to make this big scary goal measurable. So I don't want you to say, I want to do more events in 2020. I want you to say, I want to do 20 more events in 2020 than I did in 2019. The difference is that that is a measurable goal. You can say, yes, I did exactly 20 events, or maybe it's a revenue. So instead of saying, I want to double my revenue, I want you to say something like, I want to make an additional $10,000 per quarter. Okay, that is a very measurable goal. All right, that is something that is so big and scary, but also, okay, measurable. So for example, my personal goal is to teach 1,000 wedding professionals in the Strategy Academy in 2020. That means I have to reach at least 200 per quarter. Okay, do you see how easy that is to measure? Now that you have that big goal, we're going to take that big goal and we're going to break it into four steps. All right, now these are the four steps you're going to take to scale inside of your business. So let's go through what they are. The first is think. Okay, now a lot of people skip this step because they're like, I gotta do stuff, right? Okay, and so we're going to go through the think phase. I want you to sit down with your team. If you don't have a team, I want you to grab your spouse. I want you to grab the people that know your business. I want you to get a mentor. I want you to get a strategist and sit down and think. All right, think through how you're going to reach your goal. Look at it like a Candyland board and say, what steps am I going to take to get there? Think. Just simply quiet your brain and just think about your business. All right. Now, as you're thinking, you're writing down things that are coming to you. This is a concept. This is an idea. These are some things. Now, after you've done that thinking phase, I want you to take all of that thinking into real paper. Okay, and you're going to create a specific strategy for reaching that goal. What is the step-by-step process you're going to take to reach that goal? Okay, maybe you need a better marketing strategy. Okay, in order to get 1,000 people through the Strategy Academy, I have to make a better marketing plan, right? Okay, do you need a client experience process that will allow you to handle more clients? All right, do you need to increase retention so that you're getting more repeat business? And what is the plan for increasing retention? You need to have this written down. Create a plan of some kind. Use a Trello board, use a Word document, use a project management tool where everyone can see what those steps are. You're going to take this plan and put it in something really tangible for your team. Now, the real problem is a lot of people have great ideas and maybe you do the thinking. Okay, maybe you're a good thinker, right? But you're not a good planner. And so you don't actually have a place to go back and say, oh, I thought I was going to do this thing. I really thought I was going to double my revenue, but I never made a plan for how to get there. This plan is really, really important. And it is the thing you're going to go back and revisit and tweak all the time. The next step here is act. Okay. Now we all know that nothing gets done unless you take some kind of action to get it done. This is the doing part of planning, right? But what you're going to do is you're going to start implementing your strategies in your business one at a time. Okay. I want to do these things. Now you're not going to tackle it like an army rushing at something. Okay. You actually are going to tackle one thing at a time. You're going to start to see those things come to life in your actions of your business. So let's say one of the problems that you have is you want to serve more clients. So you sit down and create a new client experience plan, right? And then you start activating it in your company. And then you can start to see what's working. Okay. Oh, this really worked. Or I definitely need another template here. Or I need a questionnaire there or a form here. Okay? Or I really need a system to fill in the problem hole right here. Okay. That action like forces you to get the clarity that you need to grow your business. Okay. When you take action, then you learn. Okay. So that action causes you to look back and say, all right, so I took this action and it didn't work, it bombed. Okay, what do I need to change? I'm learning, I'm taking those things in, that data that I received from my plan and from my actions, and I'm going, okay, is this getting me closer to my big scary goal? If not, what do I need to change or tweak right in this learning phase? Now, what that means is you're gonna bounce right back into the thinking phase. And honestly, sometimes this is what frustrates small business owners, right? Because you're like, I feel like I'm never done working. I'm never done fixing. I'm never done planning, right? And the real purpose here is that you've got to change your mind and the way that you process the idea of scaling as not just a line, like everyone sees a pretty graph, right? And the pretty graph shows a line that goes forward, right? But the real truth is, in everything in life, I talk about this a lot, in everything in life, we are circular. We think, then we plan, then we act, then we learn, and then we think and we plan and we act and we learn. We have to move in a circular pattern as like wheels on a car. It's that circular pattern that moves the momentum of your business forward. You have to adopt a mindset that you're constantly changing, constantly tweaking. Now, I'm not telling you to burn it all down and start over, okay? Scaling doesn't mean burning down. Scaling means taking the great things that you just learned, all of those things like finances and marketing, right? And taking the things that you're doing great at and maximizing them, okay? So we want to look at this concept of thinking, planning, acting, and learning as the backbone of scaling into 2020. You need to have a plan to do that. You need to make sure you've got everything in place as you scale into 2020. Everything that we covered here, marketing, finances, setting those resolutions, getting an idea of your team, getting a handle on your time, will help you to push that level of growth in your business that you're looking for in 2020. So we want to give you some support for these goals as you go into 2020. Listen, you're going to need resources, you're going to need team, you're going to need to get some things in place. So first thing we wanted to do is give you some resources.
Yep. And so we're going to kind of coast through a couple of these resources. There's so many out there. We just wanted to highlight a few. Obviously, as Kellie mentioned, it's important to keep learning. That is a cyclical process. So one of the first places you can learn is in her wedding industry resource library.
Yeah, it's awesome. Actually, it's the largest resource library in the wedding industry. It was designed so that anybody at any level of serving wedding couples, if you serve wedding couples at all, you're going to find something in here. It is all business education. There's no trade education, but there's webinars and trainings. There's guides. There's interviews. Everything that you can possibly imagine is in the resource library and is 100% donation based. It runs the councils and leadership program that we have at Wedding Industry Institute. So go check it out. It's just Wedding Industry Resource Library on our website. You can find it there.
Great. And then another thing I wanted to recommend was I'm obsessed with my CSS feed. So for folks who don't know what that means, there's a bunch of different ones out there. I use feedly.com or maybe it's feed.ly. I'll have to double check. I can send it out to all you participants when we send out the recording. But what it does is you can put in, you can see I have different groupings here. It's a little embarrassing because you can also see that I sometimes follow celebrity gossip. But I put in all my different things, everything from work, marketing and advertising. I've got a few others on a different board, wedding specific publications, some of the local blogs I follow. And you can group them out and you can follow specific blogs and or both. You can follow specific topics and it'll make suggestions. And what it does is you can see they come in as an email style. So it makes it really easy for me to just skim, sometimes just while I'm waiting for public transportation or when I'm at the gym or when I'm watching TV, I'll kind of skim through the headlines and then save the ones I want to read later. It makes it really easy because I know how overwhelming it is. There's so many blogs out there. How do you go and visit all of them? This sort of lets them come to you. It looks like an email. And again, you can skim and say, ooh, that's a topic I want to read on, and click to save to read it later. And one of the blogs I hope you'll consider for your CSS feed is our blog. So even if you are not a fit for our software, which I'm happy to chat with you about separately, you are definitely a fit if you're in the events industry for our blog. And if you go to goodshufflepro.com/blog, you'll see we talk about everything from dealing with difficult clients to making New Year's resolutions for your business and anything in between. So check that out as well.
Yes, and it is a great resource. I talked a lot today about Trello. Trello is like a Kanban style way of project management. It's a bit like having a wall of organized post-it notes. I love it. It's the way I run a lot of my business, but there are other tools, other project management tools. So if you're looking for something, drop in project management tools in into your Google search bar and you'll find a ton of tools. Trello is the one I like. Also, we talked a little bit about productivity and people that maybe watch more cat videos than they should be. You might need a tool like AppBlock. AppBlock will allow you to shut down notifications, allow you to shut down apps so you actually can't use them during certain periods of time. So you don't have the potential that you get back on Instagram stories while you're supposed to be working. That's a great way to manage your time.
Another tool I wanted to mention was Capterra.com. They are basically like Yelp, but for software companies. So what they do is aggregate reviews. They make it really easy for you to sort by what your business is and see the different software opportunities out there. So that's a great place to check. And then the last thing we wanted to say about resources is our communities. So obviously Kellie has a very important one.
Yeah, so the Wedding Industry Education Community is a online Facebook community, totally free for everyone to join. If you serve wedding couples at all and you are interested in growing your business, it is the place for you to hang out. There's about 8,000 plus global wedding professionals. And we talk about business every single day.
And you need those people, you need those cheerleaders, you need a support network. It doesn't have to just be people who have your exact same business. If you are in tents, it's important to know other people in tents, but it's also really nice to get the perspective of the folks who are providing the decor inside those tents. If you are a planner, it's really nice to hear what a DJ has to think. So I think it's really important that you cross those lines. And Kellie and I also are very much available. I'm gonna throw up our contact information here in a minute. But wanted to do a quick review as I know we're coming up on time here. These are the steps you're about to take, and we are really excited for you to take them. I'm really excited to take them myself. The first thing you want to do is that marketing and sales audit. Of course, you're going to want to be looking for your ROI there. Then you're going to want to do your productivity audit. Again, with our obsession with time, productivity is the best way you can do that. You are only given X number of hours in the day, right? 24 to be exact, but you can maximize it. And then your financial audit, including reflecting on that time where your money is being lost to time, as well as where you might even spend more money. And then that plan to scale now for 2020, that idea of growth. You do not want to be coming into our webinar next December and going, yeah, I didn't really hit any of those goals, right? The goal is to say, wow, I've come a long way in just 12 months.
Absolutely. So if you need to reach out to us, if you have any questions at all, drop them in the box. We'll sit here and answer them for you. But you can always reach us at Wedding Industry Institute. I'm Kellie Daab. There is my email as well as our Instagram. Get connected with us in the community. We're happy to answer any business or scaling questions that you have, as well as connecting with Karen.
Yep, you can find me at Karen@goodshuffle.com. You can follow us on Instagram as well. And again, you know, regardless if you are in the rental or production or design industry, there's a great chance that we are a fit for you. If you are not and you have other questions, or you maybe want to say, hey, I don't know if your software is right for me, but do you have any other recommendations? I'm an open book. Shoot me an email. I'd be happy to help as much as I can.
Thank you so much. This was such a great time.
Thank you, Kellie, for your time. And thank you all for participating. I'm not